This Family Life News Podcast is made possible by the support of listeners like you.
And welcome back to another edition of Capital Connection. Fridays during the Noon Report, we give you direct connection to all that's happening in Albany and Harrisburg with the experts on the issues at the state capitals. They are Jason McGuire with New York Families and Michael Geer at the Pennsylvania Family Institute. I want to begin this week, guys, with a poll that I could not believe. You know, I see a lot of polls having to do with politics, but this one shocked me, and I'm not easily shocked anymore. This is from the Culture Research Center, Dr. George Barna's group out in Arizona. Anywhere from 32 to 41 million Christians plan not to vote in the upcoming election. You know, Jason, I wonder what the reason is for that. Maybe in New York they say, well, my vote doesn't matter, or I don't like any of the candidates, so I'm just going to sit at home. What's your reaction to that survey?
Yeah, my reaction is very similar to yours. I mean, we kind of live and work in this environment, and so we shouldn't be shocked by these things anymore. And yet you hear that number, and it was stunning. I mean, to think that there are tens of millions of believers who will sit at home or will not vote in this election, I just think there's a moral and a biblical responsibility to stand up and do something. If you had the ability to preserve liberty for future generations, if you had the opportunity to stem the tide of violence towards the unborn child or towards children that are being mutilated or children being sex trafficked across the border, I believe there's a moral obligation to stand up. And so I plead with brothers and sisters in Christ not to sit this one out, but to get up and get involved up and down the ballot.
And we're going to talk about why you need to get involved in a minute. But first, Michael, your reaction, why so many Christians plan to sit out the upcoming election.
Well, I agree with what Jason said and implore people to vote here in Pennsylvania. Obviously, we're a swing state. The radar screens are all looking at Pennsylvania, what's going to happen in this election. And whether Christians and people of values turn out is going to make the difference here in Pennsylvania for everybody across the nation. It's troubling to see. I know it's been a concerted effort by some to tell Christians they shouldn't be using their influence in society. We even here at Pennsylvania Family get attacked by news media and others saying we're somehow we're trying to take over. Yeah. The reality is that we all have a voice. We all are part of the government. As citizens, we should be exercising that voice. And if we don't, it leaves a vacuum. And there are plenty of people with a different worldview who are happy to walk in and take over that vacuum and lead society in a place we don't want it to go.
Well said. If you need any reason to vote, Jason, Prop 1 is it. The proposed amendment in New York on the ballot this fall. Does it undermine parental rights? Does it endanger girls' sports? Does it infringe on religious freedoms? Will it allow illegal immigrants to vote? There are a lot of questions about this. I want to ask you this question, though, Jason. Are there protections for religious groups should this proposal be approved?
Well, nothing adequate. The problem with Prop 1 is it's going to elevate the status of women seeking an abortion or those in the LGBTQ community to essentially the same status as religious liberty. And the problem is the way the prop is done and the way the courts function in New York, there will be this desire to lift up abortion and the LGBT agenda over religious liberty. And so, you know, for churches and pregnancy centers and others, we're very concerned about how the courts are going to interpret Prop 1 should it pass.
And the danger, on the surface, this looks really appealing. But once you read the fine print, things don't look so rosy. When it comes to biological boys playing girls' sports, there's going to be a walkout next week to protest that. If you would, talk about what's planned next Thursday.
Yeah, there's what's being called a walk-off for fairness day, hashtag girl con instead of a boycott, right?
Yeah.
Where athletes are being encouraged to walk off the practice fields or their competitions on October 24th as a protest against Proposal 1, but also really to save, you know, girls' sports in this state. We hear oftentimes from the left students protesting so many different things. These are girls that are standing up for their own safety in competition. There are girls that are being brutalized by some of these sporting events against male athletes. So that walk-off for Fairness Day is October 24th, and there will be many people across the state of New York participating on that particular day.
All right. Thank you, Jason. Hey, Michael, a report report out. Your colleague, Dan Barkoak, did so much great work on raising awareness about this. Young children in Pennsylvania being experimented on with sex reassignment drugs and procedures. I got to ask you, how rampant is this sort of social experimentation and how damaging are its effects?
It's pretty widespread. And here in Pennsylvania, there's an organization we've partnered with called Do No Harm that has issued a report. Children's Hospital of Philadelphia is ground zero nationally for promoting puberty blockers and sex hormones and even surgeries on minors. It leaves these children permanently mutilated. More than $20 million of taxpayer dollars is spent on doing surgeries and these hormone blockers, and it's devastating, it's wrong. And this is another reason why people need to get out and vote. These are the kinds of issues that in states where they elect solid legislatures, they ban this kind of stuff. Here in Pennsylvania, we can protect children in the future.
Yeah, and this is becoming something of a cottage industry for Planned Parenthood as well. This is kind of their big moneymaker now. And this is not just one or two kids this is happening on. This is thousands of young children in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, Planned Parenthood, not only, you know, they're known for abortion, but they also do school curriculum. They go in and do this kind of transgender ideology, teaching it there. And then you go to a Planned Parenthood clinic and they provide these cross-sex hormones and puberty blockers for kids and adults. It's wrong, and people need to be aware of it and get engaged to try and stop it.
Yeah, we encourage everyone to go and read Dan's article on this on your website. We'll give that at the end. But first, Jason, Governor Hochul signed a series of bills on gun violence last week. I think they were six in all. Anything from a Second Amendment perspective that concerns you with those laws?
Well, you know, not from our organization's perspective, but from just a strictly Second Amendment perspective, it will allow the tracking of firearm and ammunition purchases through your credit cards, like a special code for that. And so essentially, there's going to be this database out there that will track when people purchase firearms or ammunition. I think that's concerning for a lot of people across, particularly upstate New York.
Yeah, there are a few legislative victories or judicial victories, I should say, Michael, but there was one, a big one, in Pennsylvania recently. You're calling this one a win for parental rights. It has to do with three moms and their first grade children and some controversial gender identity curriculum. If you would explain that court case.
Yeah, this involved the first grade students at Mount Lebanon School District, which is south of Pittsburgh, a suburban school district. The first grade teacher there showed a movie to the students called Jacob's New Dress for the 6 and 7 year old students. She read from books whose subject matter included gender dysphoria and gender transitioning. So when these parents became aware of this and said, why is this being promoted with our first graders? They filed a lawsuit, and thankfully a federal judge offered a summary judgment against the school district and against this teacher. It is a win for parental rights.
And Jason, there was a win as well. New York, not every day that pro-family bills get signed by Governor Hochul. Hey, you'll take them when you can get them, right? But there were three bills that she signed recently, and they all happened on the same day, correct? October 1st? Explain the good the governor did there.
Yeah, three bills signed on October 1st that we're pleased to see. The first would allow pregnant women to enroll in health insurance without a penalty during a special enrollment period. This really helps women that want to carry their babies to term be able to get the health insurance coverage they need. The second thing is it would require health insurance plans to cover prenatal vitamins. And then the final thing deals with mobile sports betting. And this would include warnings about the potential harmful and addictive effects of gambling would have to be applied in various sports betting advertisements. So while it's sad to see so much sports betting growing here, I'm thankful for at least a little protection here in this area.
Well, you can't watch anything on sports like everywhere. It's all over the place. So we're glad to see that. And then finally, Michael, efforts afoot in the Pennsylvania House to dismantle divorce law. This bill would make it easier to dissolve a marriage by repealing and replacing the Pennsylvania Divorce Code. You argue this is wrongheaded. How come?
There's a variety of reasons. Marriage is the best health, education, and welfare institution ever devised for children with a mom and a dad. The nation has really suffered the side effects of no-fault divorce. But one of the things that is in current Pennsylvania law, it says the family is the basic unit in society, and the protection and preservation of the family is of paramount concern. This new proposal would take that language out of the state law and also just grease the skids to make divorce easier. We understand there are situations of abuse and others
that necessitate divorce, sadly, but we shouldn't be making it still easier and more efficient. That's a wrong-headed thing to do.
All right, and with that, we will have to stop this week, but wow, a lot of places we've been the last 10 minutes. If folks want to learn more about Prop 1 in New York and why it's so dangerous, why they need to vote no on that proposal, Jason, you're writing about it online. Where can folks find you?
NewYorkFamilies.org.
And the Do No Harm Report, thousands of Pennsylvania children being experimented on through controversial surgeries. Michael, you have an article on that on your website as well. Where can folks read more?
PAFamily.org.
Thank you for listening to this Family Life News Podcast. If you've been encouraged by what you've heard, please share it with others and click the subscribe button to automatically receive future episodes. Family Life is a listener-supported ministry. Podcasts like this are made possible by your financial partnership. Find out more at familylife.org.